The last video here on Numberphile was all about gaps between prime numbers. Specifically, it was about this paper, which is a proof that's just been published. And what it basically says is no matter how high you go in the number line, no matter how high you count, there is always a pair of numbers still to come with a gap of less than 70 million. What that exact number is, it doesn't quite say. Now, 70 million sounds like a really big number, but when you think how big numbers can get and how rare prime numbers become as you get higher and higher, it's pretty close. But what's really exciting is that a lot of people are saying this paper has taken us a step closer to proving the twin prime conjecture. And what that says is that there are an infinite number of prime numbers separated by just two. So that means no matter how high you count, whether you get to a Googleplex or Graham's number or well beyond, there is still an infinite number of prime numbers ahead of you that are separated by just two. And when you get that high, prime numbers become incredibly rare. So to think that all these pairings are still out there is quite an extraordinary thought. Now, this proof is 56 pages long and it's probably beyond most people, but we did make a video about it and I hope you've watched that already. And if you did, well, there's a few off-takes and a few extra bits and pieces from that video that we didn't use that I've now put into this video. So have a watch of that, and then I'll tell you what I think of this paper at the end.
I love it. I love it. Yeah, I mean, well, I get excited about everything, but I've always loved numbers. And, I mean, just look at the magnitude of the kind of things. How on earth has someone come up with that these are the primes, the largest twin pair primes, and who knows what the significance of these will be. I mean, I love it just for the sake of mathematics and the numbers, and I'm full of admiration for people that can do this. When I was 18, I sort of had a decision to make whether to do physics or whether to do mathematics, and I went the physics route, and I'm very happy I did, but if I'd have gone the mathematics route, this is the kind of thing I would have loved to do, but I'm not sure I'm good enough.
So the ones that differ by two are called twin primes. You also get, of course, ones that differ by four. Okay, these are called cousin primes. And there's even those that differ by six. And these are called sexy primes. Okay, now in principle, it's believed as well, it's believed there's an infinite number of these twin primes. It's believed there's an infinite number of these cousin primes. It's believed there's an infinite number of these sexy primes. In fact, it's believed that there is an infinite number of, you know, each possible even gap between the primes, but it's not been proven. So what we have here is a pair of primes, and they differ by 2n. What Zhang has shown is that there are an infinite number of prime numbers where this difference does not exceed 70 million. There are an infinity of these guys. What's even more remarkable, actually, about the proof that Zhang came up with, is that he didn't actually do anything completely different, right? It was really just application of existing ideas, but just perseverance. And that's quite unusual. Sometimes when something hasn't been proven for a very, very long time, it really needs some sort of order of magnitude shift in the way people think. But this one didn't happen here. He just really stuck at it, perhaps more than others had. You know, and it's a pretty impressive proof. There's no doubt about it. Here it is, 56 pages of it. So 70 million is not really a, you know, I was talking about, you know, potentially the Googleplex is Graham's number, these kind of crazy numbers. But, you know, even then, there's gaps of only 70 million. So it's a tiny number in that context. But actually, it's believed, of course, it's a lot bigger than two or four or six here, right? It is believed that the methods that Zhang used could be optimized even more, and you could get this number down to 16. That's what's anticipated here. So that would be, you know, pretty impressive that there's always going to, if there's an infinite number of prime numbers that are separated by only 16 numbers, that would be really impressive.
But not two. They don't reckon he can get it to two.
It's not anticipated that these methods would actually get it down to two. No, it's 16 is the optimum. And it's related to the fact that a lot of what Zhang did was based on work of these guys, Goldston, Pince and Yildirim. And they sort of almost got there. They almost got there. What they proved was, they had to, Well, they proved a couple of things. One thing that they proved was that so you have this average gap of log n, okay? So that's the average gap of between prime numbers. So for example, if n is a Googleplex, this average gap is around a Google, is of that order anyway. Okay, so now the question is, you know, so what did Goldstein, Pintz, and Yildirim show? They showed that you take any fraction you want, so I take some large n, you take any fraction you want of this gap, and I can prove that the gap between primes is less than, so I take some fraction, let me call it epsilon, so any epsilon greater than zero. GPY showed that there exists, so I'm going to show you a little bit of mathematical symbol here, that there exists, okay, that means there exists, that backward E, showed that there exists prime pairs separated by less than epsilon log n for large enough n. Okay, so you might think, so what he's showing, and this is any epsilon, okay, this just falls short of proving the conjecture. Now, why does it just fall short? Well, in principle, I could just take n bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. If n's finite, then, you know, then okay, that's fine. But, you know, n can be infinite here. N can really get big. So that's not enough, because it just falls short of proving the conjecture, because n, we're talking big N here, and n, essentially, you want to tend n to infinity, ultimately, to prove that there are an infinite number of these pairs. So no matter how, you know, okay, you can take this fraction to be arbitrarily small, but the thing it's multiplying is getting arbitrarily big, so it's not clear that this overall size is actually getting smaller and smaller, can stay small, can even stay finite, it may even become infinite. So they fell just short of proving the conjecture.
Well, so our hero of the day today has also fallen short of proving the big conjecture.
Well, no, but he at least proved that there was a finite gap. But ultimately, there is a finite gap, you know, and there's an infinite number of these guys with a finite gap. So what GPY did show, and this is where the 16 comes in, is they showed that if something called the Elliott-Halberstam conjecture is true, and we don't know it's true, it's expected to be true, but they don't know it's true, then there are an infinite number of prime numbers which differ by less than 16. So this is where the 16 comes in.
Yeah, just to go back to our hero of today, what is it about his proof that makes 70 million fall out? It seems such an arbitrary number, and yet it's such a perfect round number.
Okay, so when people do number theory, how do they actually go about doing these proofs? They tend to use sieve theory. Now, the simplest version of a sieve theory comes back from ancient Greece, a guy called Eratosthenes.
He wanted to work out what all the primes were, so he began by just writing out all the numbers. So yeah, he begins with 2, because you know 1 isn't going to be, 1's not defined as a prime. So he begins with 2, 3, 4, and I'll do 31 and 32. Okay, and it goes on and on, of course. And what he said was you begin at 2. So that's going to be your first number, and you now cross out every number that's divisible by 2.
Okay? Why?
Because that can't be a prime. A prime is defined as a number that's divisible only by itself, or possibly by 1, but 1 doesn't count usually. So we begin with 2, so 4, of course, all the even numbers now, immediately you wipe out. I'm sieving, they're falling through the sieve, right? That's exactly what's going on, and so I've got rid of them. So now you move to 3, which is the next one by itself, and you do the same 3. Well, 6 already has been ruled out, but 9 goes, 12 is already gone, 15 goes, 27 goes, 30 is gone. 4 is already gone, 5 is the next one, okay? And, you know, so then you start going through, 10 is, so anything divisible by 5 is removed. So 10 is already gone, 15 is already gone, 20 is already gone, 25 hasn't gone yet, but has now. What you're now left with, actually, are all the primes. If I just label the ones that are left, you've got 11, 13, 17, 19, 23, 29, 31. I've got all the primes up to 31, and this is the technique that you can use to actually sieve out the primes. This would give me all the primes, right? If I had enough computing power and enough time and I could do it fast, I would get all the primes just by writing out this series and just doing it.
And in all infinity of them?
In all infinity of it. It would take me a long, long time, an infinite amount of time.
It would take you a long
time.
But
I could
do it.
Do
you know how long it would take you?
Infinite amount of time.
Yeah.
So we haven't got that, and the funding agencies won't fund us for that kind
of.
We
don't have an infinite amount of time. We've got another 26 minutes.
So what people have done is they've refined this sieve, in such a way that it's not as accurate as this. So maybe you think of it as a bit more coarse-grained sieve, and so more things will fall through. But what you are left with are rather than having these fine primes immediately left, what you're left with are groups of numbers with which you improve your chances of finding the primes. So you have some idea of the kind of values of numbers you're looking for, you develop your sieve accordingly, and then all the other stuff comes through and you're left with this range of numbers within which you hope you're going to find these big primes. Just look at the sizes that we're kind of talking about. And so these modified sieves are used by mathematicians to try and establish these bounded sets. And that's basically, the work of Zhang has been based on some earlier work by a group of mathematicians who showed that who almost got there to find this this bound, but couldn't quite make it. And what he did is he basically modified the sieve that he was using, which meant he had just a slightly different way of getting the bigger prime numbers, and from it he was able to demonstrate that indeed there is a bound, and just based on the type of sieve he was using, this bound turned out to be 70 million that he came up with.
So 70 million is an artifact of the sieve that he
arbitrarily
chose.
There are two things. There's a sieve and then there's a something which I just can't get my head around called the level of distribution, which tells you how the prime numbers, how regular they become when you're looking on very large values. And so it was this combination that he used and out of it, which no one else had been able to do. And there is a nice sort of aspect to this story, which is he's over 50. Okay, no one knew about him. He works at the University of New Hampshire. He'd obviously been working away, which means you can do great maths over 50. You're not totally burnt out. And B, that he wasn't that he came up with some phenomenally new breakthrough. He just kept plugging away at the techniques people had been doing, and just by doing that was able to modify them sufficiently to make this. And it's been... He sent it to the journal in April, and the journal editor, to their credit, mathematics journals must be inundated with people saying they've solved these problems. Because the problems are so easy to say, right? There's an infinite number of primes who differ by two. I bet there's... I remember trying to prove this at school, thinking that can't be that difficult.
The number file inbox is inundated with people claiming.
I'm sure it is. So to their credit, the editors of the journal realized this guy knew what he was talking about. Apparently the paper was beautifully written, crystal clear, and they fast-tracked it through the refereeing process. They must have some way of putting it on a conveyor belt that sends it to the referees, who all unanimously said this is potentially really important.
I scanned the proof and then I went online and found some really nice sort of explanations from, because one thing that that happened is, so he gave a talk at Harvard, and it was extremely well received, and people were very excited about it, and there's people coming because everybody loves prime numbers, right? So there were people coming from different fields to see this talk, and but what people have done is, some people who were at that talk have put some really nice sort of explanations online of the proof involved. And so those are, I found, particularly useful, because they were coming from people who weren't, they were written by people who weren't number theorists, but, and I'm not a number theorist, so that was very useful to me. But incidentally, there's a nice little sort of quirk of fate, which happened when while that talk was going on, in that a paper came online while that talk was going on, which actually proved another one of these sort of crazy conjectures. It was the Goldbach conjecture, or at least a weakened version of the Goldbach conjecture, which says, so the original Goldbach conjecture, which is one of the great problems of mathematics, it's one of the, you know, it's one of these millennium, you get one of these millennium prizes if you solve it, is that every even, to prove that every even number can be written as the sum of two primes. Okay, so the weakened version that this guy proved that it came out while Zhang was giving his talk was that every odd number greater than five can be written as the sum of three primes. So he proved this, a slightly weakened version of the original conjecture. And so it's kind of, there's been sort of two really big events within number theory sort of coming together at the same time. And, you know, the implications for this in terms of, now that there's new ideas coming in, there's even hope that maybe one could solve the Riemann hypothesis, which is, so the Riemann hypothesis states that there's a particular function called the Riemann function, which I can write down quite straightforwardly. It has the form zeta of z is the sum over n of 1 over n to the z. Okay, the Riemann hypothesis asks, where are the zeros of this function? Okay, and it seems, what he says is that they all lie, so in the complex plane, we're thinking, where are they in the complex plane? They all lie on the line with real number a half. Not obvious, it's a hypothesis. Great minds have failed to prove this time and time and time again. And one thing that that is hoped is that we now might be progress to solving, to proving this. So, you know, all these things together, there's kind of hope there's going to be real progress now. Incidentally, we use this Riemann zeta function in quantum field theory as well. So this has applications sort of beyond just number theory.
I mean, you're a physicist, not a mathematician. Mm. Does this excite you when you read about this and see this?
I think everybody loves prime numbers, don't they? I think you know, you can't fail to love prime numbers. You know, I think the great thing, I was thinking about this, because I knew you'd ask me that, Brady. I was thinking, the thing about prime numbers that I think fascinates anybody who's interested in maths, physics, that kind of thing, is that they seemingly lack some sort of structure. They seem to, everything that we like to think that we understand nature, that things ultimately will adhere to some sort of structure and that we can make sense of that. Thus far, prime numbers seem to sort of evade that possibility. They seem to just be so higgledy-piggledy. What is the structure that underpins prime numbers? And these sort of conjectures are sort of going some way towards giving prime numbers this really, these elusive things that are really refusing us thus far refused to sort of, you know, come under the grip of us trying to make sense of them and to apply structure to them. These sort of conjectures and proving them is heading some way to doing that. And that's why it's sort of like, you know, is it almost the final frontier of our understanding in some way? We're making sense of something that's so everybody can understand what three is a prime number or five is a prime number, you know, and it's something that's so sort of familiar to us. And yet, seemingly, we understand so little about. I guess that's the fascination.
Do you know what else a prime number is? What? 19.
19.
Stuart Downing.
Oh, yeah, yeah. He's had a good second half of season, Stuart Downing, actually.
Was he a good signing?
I don't want to say definitely, yeah. he had a good second half of season, I will say that, and his form's improved.
So this paper by Yitang Zhang, which is, by all accounts, an extraordinary piece of work, it's well beyond my capabilities, but I did note it's 56 pages long, and I think the typesetters have missed an opportunity here. If they kind of just made the point size a bit bigger or put a bit more spacing in there, they could have got it to 59 pages, and that's a twin prime. You know that's what I would have done.